Yeah, it's your boy Chili. Welcome back to Hardware 3D. Today, I got some good stuff for you. We're going to dive into architecture type stuff. And what we're going to be doing is we're going to be basically giving our drawable, bindable system an extreme makeover. It's going to become a lot cleaner. It's also going to become a lot more powerful. You're going to love it. So before we jump into the changes, we should do a quick little review of the current system. Because it's kind of complicated, and it would behoove us to have a good understanding of what we have right now before we talk about how to make it better. So, in the current system, you have basically the drawable, and it's just a big bin where you chuck bindables into. You should understand at this point, it should be very clear to you, that how you draw things in Direct3D is you bind things to the pipeline, things like shaders, things like vertex buffers. You bind all the things you need to the pipeline, and then you call draw on the pipeline, which means calling a Direct3D function draw. Drawable exists as a container to hold all the necessary bindables. And when it's time to draw a drawable, you loop through all the bindables, you bind them all to the pipeline, and then you call draw on Direct3D. That part isn't very complicated. So we've got this base class drawable that has the container, and then you can, inherit from it to create your specific drawable types like sphere and plane, and you create instances of those, and those instances all have their own pool of bindables. Now that's great, but the one problem that we had with this is there's a lot of duplication. Like all spheres, it's very likely that they're all going to be using the same, let's say, pixel shader. So if we had to duplicate that pixel shader for every instance of sphere, that's a lot of waste. We would like to be able to share pixel shaders between instances of sphere because they're all identical. And that's what this bullshit is in here. So we create another vector. This vector here is a piece of member data. We create another vector that is static data. All right. So there exists one for the entire class. So here is the pixel shader. All spheres can use that pixel shader. Here is the binds that are specific to every individual sphere. And the only complicated part of this really is the fact that we have to template this, right? So sphere inherits from drawable base templated on itself. It's a little weird, but it works. It gives us separate static pools for every different type of drawable class, and everyone is happy. But like any other system, it has its drawbacks, right? What are some of the drawbacks? Well, I mean, it's nice that we have separate shared pools for separate drawable classes. But what if we wanted to share at a higher level? What if we wanted, for example, what if spheres and planes use the same vertex shader? Wouldn't it be nice if we could share? And the problem is we can't with the current system. We have to duplicate that for every different class here. Now another problem, if we're loading a model from a file like an OBJ file, what we're doing is instead of having a rigid defined set of bindables that are defined at compile time or defined at coding time by the programmer in the constructor of sphere or plane, instead we are looking at the object file, looking at what kind of material it has, and choosing our bindables based on that, or at least that is what we're going to be moving into. So instead of it being a rigid, fixed at compile time set of bindables that we can define in our constructor, the code that loads the object file, the parsing code, is creating the set of bindables, and the actual drawable, its constructor, just receives a big handful of bindables and puts them inside of itself. If that makes any sense. So it doesn't make sense to have these separate inheritance of sphere and plane and whatever. It makes more sense to just have a single class called mesh that inherits from drawable. Its constructor does pretty much nothing. It just accepts a collection of bindables via dependency injection, basically via the constructor, and then it just puts them inside of its own container. And that is the kind of system that we're moving towards. So here's the system now that I propose. As you can see, it looks a lot simpler, or at least it should. Again, we have a drawable abstract class. It has a container of bindables. and we're going to be able to inherit from that. And the main thing that we're going to inherit is mesh. This is the thing that will be created in our ASIMP asset loading code, the thing that loads the models. So you can see right here, we've eliminated the separation between instance binds and static binds. We just have binds. So you may be wondering, okay, well then how do you share? The way we share is because this binds is a vector of shared pointer. So we're going to use shared pointer to be able to share these resources. And we're going to have, instead of having, you know, one static pool for spheres and one static pool for planes, we're going to have one giant pool of bindables. And all of our drawables, regardless of, you know, whether it's mesh or whether it's some other kind of drawable that inherits here, they're all going to have pointers into bindables that are in this container here, this global container. We'll call it codex. So by this system, we don't have the problem where, you know, sphere and plane, they have to duplicate identical bindables. That's not a problem anymore. You only have one place where bindables are referenced to. And we don't have to worry about managing, you know, instance binds versus static binds. Every drawable will just have a single pool of bindables. So let's take a look at the code here. We're going to be spending most of our time probably inside of Gitkraken here, because that's a nicer view on the code changes. Here are the commits. Let's start with here. Unified bind container with shared pointer. So instead of having a container of instance binds and a container of static binds, we are going to just have a single container. And that means we're not going to need drawable base anymore, so I've erased that. In drawable.h, what do? Well, we remove any references to drawable base, obviously. I got rid of this update function because we weren't using it anymore. So it was just a waste of time, a waste of space. So I got rid of that. And the functions add bind, add index buffer, and get static binds. Replace that all with just a single function add bind. And we can see here now it's taking a shared pointer to bindable. And the container of binds is now, again, a shared pointer, a vector of shared pointers. When we draw a drawable, we now only have to loop through a single container to draw it. Everything else is the same here. And when we add a bindable, remember, I removed add index buffer. I've made it simpler. So now there's only a single function to add bindables. And when you add a bindable, the function will check to see if it's an index buffer. And if so, it sets that index buffer pointer. And it also checks to see if you've already set an index buffer. So if you've set one, you can't add another one. You will get an assertion if you're, you know, running in debug mode. Then in mesh.h, what do we do here? Well, now we're inheriting mesh from drawable. Don't have to inherit from drawable base with this templating bullshit anymore. And mesh is going to take in a vector of shared pointer instead of unique pointer. In mesh.cpp here, we don't have to worry about this, you know, static initialized bullshit anymore. We just add a bind for the topology. We loop through all the bind pointers and we add them. We don't have to check for the index buffer and do anything special. So that's obviously a lot cleaner. This code has become a lot cleaner if you look at how much has been removed versus how much has been added. And down here again, we replace make unique with make shared. So it's mostly the same stuff. Let's look what happens down here. Mostly what you're going to see is unique pointer being replaced with shared pointer. But otherwise, everything is pretty much exactly the same. So it's a very simple fix. So all in all, it's very simple to refactor drawable stuff to use a single pool of shared pointers. But the thing is, now that we're doing this, we are no longer actually sharing any bindables between our instances. They all have their own separate bindables. There's no more shared pool. So now we need a way of sharing with those shared pointers. And that's what we do in this commit up here. But before we do that, we actually do a little refactoring of the solid sphere, because before it wasn't using the dynamic vertex code. It was still using the old style of defining a vertex layout. So now that that's done, we can create our bindable codex. And this is going to be the central container, which stores all of the bindables and which will enable sharing bindables between different drawables. So if we look at the bindable codex, it has an unordered map, which is basically a hash, and it hashes from string to a shared pointer to bindable. So every bindable is going to have a unique identifier, which is a string. And that is what we're going to be using in order to look up bindables and to see if we have identical bindables so that we can share them. So basically, it is a singleton you call get, and that returns a single static instance of the codex. So you'll only ever have one being created. Now, this is private. You can't call this from the outside world. You can't get the instance. But what you can do is you can call these static functions here, and they will call get, and then they will call member functions on get. And these member functions are private. So the two member functions here are resolve and store. The main one we're going to be using is resolve, and what it does is you pass it the key, basically unique identifier for that bindable. It will search the container to see if that exists. If it exists, we return it. If it doesn't exist, we return an empty shared pointer. And then store, we'll just take a bindable in and store it. So every bindable is going to have a function to get its own UID, and then we just set that there. This system, by the way, it's going to be different in a future commit, but for right now, this is the very simple system we're using. You can resolve bindables out of the container, or you can store bindables into the container. And you can see here, I've added a virtual function to bind bindable called getUID. So now basically every bindable will have to implement this function. And then I've only migrated one of our bindables over just to test it out, because this is, like I say, this is a prototype. So the one I migrate over is vertex shader. I make the vertex shader, by the way, now only use string instead of W string. I want all my things now, instead of having some things in wide string, some things in narrow string, everything in narrow string, because that's what I'm going to be using as part of the unique identifier for every bindable. So to this bindable, I have created a function called resolve, a way to generate the UID from a path without having to create a bindable first, create a vertex shader first, and then a function getUID, which is, again, that's overriding that virtual function to get the UID of an existing vertex shader instance. So now, because we're taking it in as a narrow string, but the D3D read file to blob needs a wide string, we're doing a very poor man's conversion of narrow to wide string. Note that this will not work for special characters. So for your standard ASCII characters, this will work fine. But if you've got, characters in other languages, it's going to mess up. Later on, we might make this better. But for right now, I don't really care. The resolve function is very simple. When you call resolve, it will get you a new bindable of the type vertex shader. You pass it graphics. You pass it the path of the bindable, or the path of the shader. And what it's going to do here is, at first, it's going to try to resolve that shader out of the codex, an existing built version of that shader. So we have to generate the UID based on the path, and then we try to resolve that out of the container. And if we fail to resolve it, then we're going to create one and insert it into the codex. And generate UID is very simple. It is just the path of the shader plus the name of the bindable. So we use type info to get the name of the bindable class. And to the end of that, we append some information that will identify it from, other vertex shaders. And vertex shaders can be uniquely identified by their path. So that's what we're going to use. So the final design that I went with is going to push more logic up into the codex and have less of it in the individual bindables. So let's take a look at the better system for bindable codex. So we can see right away, we've removed the store function. There is now only a single resolve function. And this one is going to either return the bindable type from the container, or it is going to create that bindable type inside of here. So it does both in one shot. Now, because it has to create the bindable type in this function, it needs to receive all of the constructor parameters in here. But every bindable has a different set of constructor parameters that it requires. And so that is why we have to use our good old friend parameter packs here. So you've got the parameter pack. The static function calls the member function resolve, the private one in here. And the private member function is going to call generate UID on the type of bindable that we're trying to create, forwarding all the parameters minus the instance of graphics. Generate UID will have to be able to accept all the same parameters that the constructor can accept. And from those parameters, it will generate a unique ID, which is a string. we'll try to find the bindable using that UID. If we find it, great. We just return a copy of a shared pointer to that one. So now we'll have two shared pointers referencing the same bindable. But if it can't find that unique ID in our container, then we have to create that bindable type. We pass it the graphics instance. We pass it all of the other parameters. And then once we've created it, we can insert it into our container and we can also return. So now if we look at sampler.h, let's look at the diff view here. We've added three functions and we're going to have to add these functions to basically every bindable we have. So resolve is the function that you'll call to create every sampler, every bindable that you want to create. You might be saying, well, Chili, why don't you just call resolve on the, the bindable codex here? Why don't you just call this resolve templated on the type of bindable that you want to create? And that you can do that. The problem is because this function is uses a parameter pack, we will not be able to get IntelliSense. And I really like having IntelliSense. I like it so much that I'm willing to create a resolve function for every bindable that we have so that I can have a definite set of parameters here that will make my life a lot easier. So that's the reason why we have a resolve per bindable. Generate UID is the way to generate the UID when you don't have the bindable yet. That is required by the codex down here. And get UID is the way to get the UID from an existing bindable, which will be useful later on. It's not so useful right now, but later on, this will be very useful in order to search for bindables within, let's say, a drawable. We want to query for a specific bindable. And then if we look into sampler.cpp, we can see that the resolve function is very simple. It just calls resolve on the codex with the required parameters. In the case of sampler, it doesn't have any. And the template type, which is the same type as this thing here. So this is just basically to enable IntelliSense for us. Other stuff is the same as we had before, basically. Here in app.cpp, you can see this is actually where I was testing out the resolve function before. And to it, I've added this sampler resolve stuff here. Do a little test to make sure things are working properly. And they were working properly. Now, this next commit here is where all the meat of the work was done. Because now I had to migrate all of my bindables over to the new system, allow them to support the codex. And mostly, it's a lot of copy and pasting. But every bindable, they have unique ways of being able to identify them. We have to give every bindable a way of generating a UID, basically from its parameters of creation, so that we can identify bindables that are identical and that don't need to be created twice, but can be shared. But that can be interesting for different bindables. So let's take a look at some of the interesting ones here. I mean, texture, it's not that interesting, right? Texture can be uniquely identified by its name. And we're also going to identify it by its slot, because obviously a bindable that binds to slot 1 is not identical that one binds to slot 2. They are going to have very different behaviors when used with the same shader. So, for example, for texture here, it is uniquely defined by the name of the bindable plus the path plus the slot. And I just separate them with hashes here. It doesn't really matter what you do. But I do this concatenation to generate a unique ID that can be used to uniquely identify different textures. So that's one example of generating a UID here. Now let's take a look at one that's not that simple, the input layout. So input layout can be uniquely identified by the layout itself. And luckily, we have the data for the layout at runtime because of our dynamic vertex system. We only need a way of converting that into a string. So what I've done is I've added a function to the layout called getCode. So if we look at vertex.h, what we're going to see here, if I can freaking find it, is I've added a function here, getCode, to the vertex layout. And then for every, in our map here, for every one of these different types, I've added a code for each element of the vertex layout. So p2 is for the position 2D, and p3 is for position 3D, etc., etc. Then in vertex.cpp, I've got get code on a specific element, and then I've got a function get code on the vertex layout, and that just loops through all the elements and concatenates their codes and then returns that. That's very simple. So that gets us a code that can uniquely identify any vertex layout, and then we use that here in input layout to generate the unique ID. And what I've done at the same time is now, instead of making the input layout bindable, instead of making it take a direct 3D input element descriptor, vector of those things, it now takes our own dynamic vertex layout type and uses that to generate the direct 3D layout inside of the constructor here. Now, there are things that are going to be difficult to uniquely identify. For example, vertex buffer. I mean, how do you identify that? Do you take the data of all the vertices, which could be, you know, like over a megabyte of data, and concatenate that into a single string? That would be retarded, right? So what I've decided to do instead is to allow the person who is creating the thing to add a tag. And that tag will serve as the unique identifier for the vertex buffer. And that's the same for the vertex buffer and for the index buffer, also taking a tag. Now the final bindable that we have to address is the constant buffer. How do we uniquely identify the constant buffer? Well, bindable is templated on the structure that defines the layout of the constant buffer. So we can actually use the name of the constant buffer directly as a unique identifier, because every constant buffer templated on a different structure will have a different name. Now, there are problems with this, because sometimes you don't want to share constant buffers even though they're templated on the same structure. And I think we will run into this problem in the future and we'll have to address it, possibly by also adding a tag to the end. But for right now, we are just going to assume that if you are requesting a constant buffer with the exact same structure, then you want to share that buffer. So that was a lot of work, but we got our bindables mostly all migrated over. There'll be a couple little fixes to work out there, but now we've got to actually use the new bindable codec system when we're creating our drawables. So in mesh.cpp, you can see here, and it's not that complicated. All you're going to do for the most part here is just replace this make shared stuff with resolve. So instead of make shared on texture, you're going to do texture resolve, and it's the same parameters here. It's nice. It's a shorter syntax, very clear. Just one small point here. The resolve functions, they return a shared pointer to bindable, but when we need to get the bytecode out of the vertex shader, right? And that get bytecode function obviously only exists on the derived type. So we have to do a static cast here. We do a static cast on the raw reference type, cast it to a reference to vertex shader, and then we can call get bytecode on that. After that, it's just a few little fix-ups. Like I said before, for certain situations, you want the actual bindable type, but resolve will only return a shared pointer to bindable. So to fix that up, what I've done here is, let me see if I can find it. Bindable codex here, we make resolve, instead of returning shared pointer to bindable, it returns shared pointer to T. And if we're creating a new one, we just return the one that we created. It's already the differentiated type of T. But if we're resolving out of the container is a container of shared pointer to bindable. So we need to cast that to shared pointer to T. And you can't just do a normal static cast, like static cast shared pointer T. That won't work. What you have to do is you have to use a special function from the standard library called static pointer cast. And that will allow you to cast from a shared pointer to bindable to a shared pointer to T. This is a good one to keep in mind. It's a semi-important technique when you're working with shared pointers. So it makes our code a little nicer. Here, apparently I added an assert. I cannot resolve bindables with special tag question mark. So index buffers and vertex buffers, they can have a tag. But I believe the way I did it, you can also construct a vertex buffer without resolving it with the container. So it's separate from the codec system. You can do that for any bindable. But if you're just constructing an index buffer or a vertex buffer without using it in the codec system, you don't need the tag, right? So what I've done is I've got two versions of the constructor here. One is one that takes the tag and stores it. And the other one is the one that takes no tag and just stores a question mark. So a question mark for the tag means that this bindable isn't in the codex system. It's outside of it. But that means that you can't use the question mark as the tag for a bindable that's in the codex system, because that wouldn't make any sense, right? So I just add in an assert here to make sure that if you just happen to use a question mark there, you will be made aware of that that's not good to do. And finally here, we just do a little test to make sure the sharing is working, the sharing of bindables. So what I've done is I've added a second NanoSuit model that I'm going to load here, and we can then see if indeed it does actually share bindables. So we're going to go into app.cpp here. In the constructor for app, we're going to put a breakpoint. So when the program reaches this point, it will have constructed all the models. And we can look at the app object and we can see, yeah, we've got nano, we've got nano 2, we've got our light. Light should contain the bindable, or light, I think light is a drawable itself, can't remember. Anyways, doesn't matter. What matters now is we want to look at our good old friend, the codex. Now, you can access the codex by the getter function. This is private, but the watch doesn't care about that. So we go bind codex get, and that will get us the instance of the codex, the singleton instance. Now, when you first look at this, it's going to say this expression has side effects and will not be evaluated, which might make you think it's not going to work. But here's what happens. When I had this loaded in here before I ran the program. So what it did was, as soon as the debugger attached, it tried to run this statement here, get. But at the very beginning of the program, the singleton instance hasn't been created yet. The first time you call get is when it creates the instance. And then every subsequent time you call get, it just returns the already existing static instance. The rub here is that the debugger can't call functions like this that have side effects. It's not allowed to have side effects or change the state of the program, only observe the state. So you can't use this to call get on the first time. But after it has been called, then you can call it and it won't have any problem because it won't have any side effects. It'll just return the existing instance. So when we're at this point in the program now, the instance already exists. If we refresh, now we get our instance of the codex. And we can look into it and we can see the binds. These are all the bindables that exist in our codex. And now we can see if they're actually being properly shared. So in our scene, we know that we have two NanoSuit models and we have one light indicator model. So let's see if we can't find something that should be shared. Well, I mean, for the NanoSuit, we would assume that vertex buffers and index buffers would be shared. They wouldn't be duplicated. So we have two NanoSuits, so we'd expect it to have two uses. So we look into our associative container here. Elements have the first and the second. The first is the key. The second is the actual shared pointer. Look into the shared pointer. We can look at the control block of the shared pointer and see how many uses it has. And here, we see it has three uses. And you might be saying, that doesn't make any sense. There should only be two NanoSuits. So there should be two uses. But remember, there's a shared pointer that exists in each of the NanoSuits. There's also a shared pointer that exists in the codex. So there's actually three shared pointers that are referencing our bindable. So that makes sense. Three makes sense here. And you can verify all these other boys and see that it's going to be the same story. Now this, by the way, I'm just going to mention this. This lets us know that there's something extra that we have to do for our codex. Even if all the models are destroyed and nothing in the world is using a bindable, the codex itself still has a use that will keep that bindable alive. So if you want to be able to clean out bindables from your codex when they're no longer being referenced in the world, you have to write a garbage collection function that basically loops through all the smart pointers, checks the uses, and if the use is only one, it should destroy that from the container. But that's something that we'll handle later on. By the way, we can also use this information to diagnose problems with our resource sharing, and I'm just going to demonstrate that right now. Sampler, where is it? The topology is something that should be shared by basically everything in our scene. All three objects should share the same topology because they're all drawing with index triangles. But if we look here, control block, the raw view, we see that it only has two uses. meaning there's only one object in the world that is using the topology. So we know that if our meshes are using it, we should have multiple uses, because there are multiple meshes in each nano suit, and there are two nano suits. Since we only have one use, we can probably infer that the light indicator is using it properly, but perhaps our mesh type is not using it. So we can go into mesh. Let me just try that here. Mesh.cpp. We can load that up, and we can look at the constructor for mesh. We can see the constructor here takes in the vector of shared pointers to bindable. It adds them, but it also adds one bindable in here, the topology list. And it doesn't use resolve, it uses make shared. So it is creating it independent of the codec system, and that's why it's not being properly shared. So what I'm gonna do here quick is I'm gonna go bind topology resolve. It's that simple. And now if we run this, we should expect it to have the proper use number, which should be many. It should have many uses. Uses 16, and that is more like it. One last thing I just wanna show off here is our little system with the input layout. At the end here, you can see we have the signature of the layout here, P3. That is probably gonna be for the light indicator, just a single 3D position. And here is for the nanosuit. We have position, we have normal, and we have texture coordinate. And here, by the way, is the final result running. You can see it looks about the same, except now we have two models here. And if I move one around here, you can see, yeah, we've got some duplication here. So, pretty dope. Hope you enjoyed. It is quite an improvement over our system we had before. It makes things a lot cleaner and simpler. And with the codec system, we have the ability to have a lot more sharing of identical resources. As always, I encourage you to pull the latest code from the GitHub to, you know, inspect it yourself. See if you can, you know, make sure you understand all the changes that I made. The history is all in there. And if there's things you don't really understand, feel free to ask me questions, especially on Discord is probably the best place to ask those kinds of questions. In the next video, we are going to implement normal mapping, which is it's a great effect. It's going to add a lot of detail to any of our models that use it. But it also requires a little bit of like 3D fundamentals type math that has to be explained. So it's going to be a pretty deep topic. Until then, thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, please click the like button. It helps a lot. And I will see you soon with some more Hardware 3D.